interesting, Bob Oldham, the PA down in Antlers, Oklahoma, he runs the emergency room down there. Sorry, he runs the emergency room down there. He sent me a...
You got it.
He sent me a picture of what one of our second-year students is up to.
What the heck?
A bear trap.
Whoa.
If you don't know what cutter is, that's what a cutter is right there. 180-something sutures. That's gonna be an all-nighter, so, anyway, I thought that's pretty interesting. Glad to share that with you. Lecture objectives today, there are several lecture objectives. You're gonna have lectures on things like hypertension and whatnot, but I threw them in here as sort of a summary and trying to relate it back to fluid dynamics with the cardiovascular system. Couple of definitions, and I'm sure that Jacob Held last week went over a lot of this stuff, since he is a cardiac physiologist prior to going to PA school. Blood pressure is just defined as cardiac output times the systemic vascular resistance. And the systemic vascular resistance is what we're gonna spend most of the time on today, things that alter it. You need to know what the mean arterial pressure is, and that is, the MAP is something you're gonna be able to measure with a catheter, a specific type of catheter that's placed in the heart or next to the heart. And you'll see that in the ICU a lot. Understanding the mean arterial pressure is important in terms of perfusion. And it's basically, as it says, it's the arterial pressure over the full cycle. And normally it's around 65 to 100 millimeters of mercury is what the typical MAP is. So if you look at the meaning of that, blood pressure changes with changes in cardiac output. How do you define cardiac output? Well, that's the heart rate times stroke volume. Heart rate is normally around 60 to 80. The stroke volume, the amount of fluid that leaves the left ventricle, which is almost identical to the amount of fluid that leaves the right ventricle, for obvious reasons, is about 70 milliliters. That's the ejection fraction. So your cardiac output is gonna be somewhere around 4 to 5 liters per minute based on the rate. That's what normally will change. Ejection fraction changes over time. Age or cardiac disease or other factors that influence contractility and dilation of the heart, like congestive heart failure or scar tissue from an MI, that sort of thing. Well, when you look at cardiac output, and systemic vascular resistance, what we're interested in is flow. The flow of blood through the vessels is dependent upon the resistance that it meets. And there are several factors that come into play to determine flow. You can see all of these right here. Quite a few of them. The one that I want to call your attention to, though, is the size, the diameter, or the radius of the tube. Because this is, the radius is to the fourth power here, any change in the radius is going to have profound effects on the flow rate through the tube. You can see that in this illustration here. If you look up here at the top panel, you have a healthy artery. Oh, by the way, if you look right here, most of the time this flow in terms of pressure is going to be related to the arterioles. Okay, the arterioles. So if you look at the flow up here and say, okay, this is an arteriole, we have 0% occlusion, so it's a nice, healthy arteriole. If we put the pressure at 120 millimeters of mercury, which is normal systolic blood pressure, right? Then the pressure in that vessel to restore 120 millimeters of mercury is going to be 120 millimeters of mercury. There's no resistance. Or the resistance is innate. You've not done anything to increase resistance. That's the point. If you take and put 20% occlusion in there, so the diameter of the tube is now 80% of the original. The pressure, or the flow, I should say, decreases from 100 down to 41. It's pretty remarkable. In order to get it back up to 100, you're going to have to increase the pressure behind the flow, which means you're going to have to increase the pressure to 293 millimeters of mercury. For a 20% drop in the diameter, you're going to have to increase the pressure to 293. Nobody has a blood pressure of 293 millimeters of mercury. Yet the downstream still has to get perfused. So obviously, if your blood pressure, if you're hypertensive, if you have atherosclerosis, which is what we're getting to today, causing that 20% reduction, you're going to have hypertension usually along with it, because that's one of the major risk factors. But that hypertension is trying to make up for some of that, but you're not going to get there. So you're going to have downstream hypoxemia of the tissues. If you put 80% blockage in there, you have to have a pressure behind it of 75,000 millimeters of mercury. That column of mercury would reach the moon. So this is a pretty profound slide. One other thing that while I was researching this talk, just the height of the blood column makes a difference in terms of pressure. If you see right here, because of the weight of the blood, if you're at 0.77 millimeters for every centimeter above or below the level of the heart, so at the mean arterial pressure at the heart is 100, if you are, average-sized person, if you look down in the feet, it's all the way up to 180 millimeters of mercury, and the distance here in your head drops it from 100 down to 62. No wonder if you turn on your head, the weight of blood, you can feel it in your head. Understand the weight of blood, if you're standing on your hands, the weight of blood is not just from the heart to your head, it's all the way from your toes to your head. It goes with the whole column. That's kind of cool. I don't know, I was just thinking about it when I came up with that stupid thing. If we look at the vascular system and divide it into different areas, we've kind of been over the structure of a vessel. I think last time we talked, we have an intima, we have an endothelium to start with. Endothelium, a one-cell layer endothelium that rests on a basement membrane. And then we have a little bit of connective tissue, including an internal elastic membrane. So between the endothelium and that internal elastic membrane, that's what we call the intima. The muscle layer between the internal and external elastic membrane is the tunica media. And then the connective tissue that's going to connect it to surrounding tissues, that's the tunica externa. All vessels look like that. In fact, the heart looks like that too. It just changes its name from myocardium, endocardium, and epicardium. It just changes its name, but the structure is still the same. Over here in this top panel, you have a difference, and you should pay attention to where you're going to find elastic fibers, where you're going to find muscle fibers, which vessels do you find that? Do you find those structures? And basically, you're going to find them in the arterial side and in the large veins on the venous side. Where you won't find them will be in capillaries and small venules. Now here's one thing you need to, it's interesting. If you take the aorta, which is about 2 centimeters, and the pressure inside that aorta is 120 millimeters of mercury, normally. When it comes down here in branches to provide the internal iliacs, common iliacs, not the internal, common iliacs, if you just ignore the renal arteries and every other branch that went along the way, then if you just looked at the common iliacs, the size, the diameter is half. The diameter is half of what the aorta is, and the pressure then stays the same because it's equally divided. Okay? That makes sense. So if it was, if you only had one, if you had only one common iliac and you had 120 millimeters of mercury up here and you had to cram all of that into one common iliac in order to get the flow the same, if you go back to the formula with to the full power, you're going to have to increase the pressure inside the common iliac. Well, the reason you avoid that is because you distribute, although you're decreasing the diameter, you distribute the pressure across a wider number of vessels. If you look at your aorta up there, the cross-sectional area is 4.5 centimeters squared. If you look at the arteries, the arterioles, and you get down to the capillaries, look at the cross-sectional area in your body of capillaries. It's over 4,000 centimeters squared. You've taken that pressure and just distributed it along a football field of capillaries. And that's the reason the pressure inside a capillary is very low. On the venule side, notice it's also 4,000. It's also 4,000 on the venule side. The point I want to make about this is if you look next to the next column and where your blood is, if you look on the arterial side, on the entire arterial side, it only adds up to 16% of your blood. I think that's right. And 16% of your blood is on the arterial side. That means that 84% of your blood is housed in the capillaries and in the venules. The arterial side, because of its muscular or tunica media, deals with pressure, but the venous side deals with volume. And you know about venous pooling in heart failure and edema, dependent edema. That's venous pooling. Over half of your blood is in the venous circulation. Okay. So the pressure in these different components, because of the number of the cross-sectional area, the pressure drops dramatically. Once you get down to the capillaries, it's pretty low. And on the venous side, it's barely moving. But one other point that I want to make over here, on this slide right here, when you start looking at the average internal diameter and you get to a capillary here, what's that, 0.008? How many microns? That's millimeters? Millimeters? How many microns is that?
Micrometers. Point A to state of them.
Convert that to micron.
Micron is 6, so 800?
8 microns, right? How big is a red blood cell?
7.
There you go. Okay. Just wanted a little exercise there. Just wanted to, okay. Make sure everybody's paying attention. The Joint National Convention. Have you heard about the Joint National? Have you guys talked about that yet? So this is the joint, the JNC. The JNC is a an independent organization that deals with recommendations for what is normal and elevated blood pressure. Right now we're up to the JNC 8, which was adopted about 2 years ago. There was a lot of, well, maybe longer than that, 4 years, 5 years ago, there was a lot of controversy about the JNC 8. People wound up not adopting it until much later on. These are the current recommendations for hypertension according to the JNC 8. The top panel up there, you guys know who those people are?
Little rascals.
The little rascals, yeah. Did you know that Darla was from Oklahoma?
Aww.
Yes, she was. Darla Hood was from Oklahoma. Unfortunately, she died at a very young age, 47, from complications of a appendectomy. But she was from Oklahoma. Yeah. So if you look at these recommendations here, they make a big distinction between less than or greater than 60 years of age. Before, in JNC 7, that really wasn't a distinction. Age was not a distinction. JNC 8 is recognizing that just a normal component of aging is an elevated blood pressure. And so they allow you another 10 more millimeters of mercury on the systolic diastolic side. Now, when you throw in kidney disease and diabetes, that sort of changes the game. But overall, 60 is the cutoff. If you look at treatment choices, those also changed with JNC 8. JNC 7 included beta blockers as essentially second-line therapy behind diuretics. JNC 8 got rid of beta blockers, moved them to fourth line, so that now you start with hydrochlorothiazide, essentially, and then move into ACE inhibitors or calcium channel blockers, depending on your race, for one. Because if you look at this, African Americans here, if you get down here, start with thiazide type diuretic or calcium channel blocker versus Caucasians, where you can start with an ACE or an ARB. Do you guys know what these are yet? ACEs and ARBs? Okay. An ACE inhibitor is an angiotensin-converting enzyme inhibitor. I'm going to talk about that later on. ACE inhibitors, lisinopril, monoclonals, things that end in ill, those are ACE inhibitors. That's one way to affect, to lower blood pressure. Another way is to block the angiotensin receptor. So that's called an ARB, angiotensin receptor blockers. We'll talk about those here in a little bit. And then calcium channel blockers, you know that calcium is important for muscle contraction. And so calcium channel blockers like Norvasc, amlodipine is probably the most common one. Verapamil was an old one, but pretty. These things are used to lower blood pressure. Latassi's gonna get this out the yin yang later on, so just bear with me. But there is a difference, a racial difference, between blacks and non-blacks here. I'm not gonna say Caucasians, because it's really black or African Americans and non-African Americans. Okay? And then over here on this side, again, you throw in diabetes and chronic kidney disease, it changes the landscape. Any questions on this? JNCA. So if you look at the, how it's summarized versus JNC7, what we were doing, the target goal, if you're less than 60, is 140 over 90. In JNC7, there was a pre-hypertension, so 130 to 140, and 80 to 90 was what they call pre-hypertension. So this got rid of pre-hypertension, and it just spoke, you either have it or you don't. They relaxed the VP in the elderly. My blood pressure is okay, according to JNC8, so that makes me happy. No pre-hypertension group. And as I mentioned, beta blockers like propranolol, metoprolol, they were moved to fourth line. Diuretics and the racial and disease disparity there. Okay. But then came the American College of Cardiology and the American Heart Association. And last year, this was just in November of 2017, they came out with these recommendations. These recommendations are, well, if you go by these recommendations, everybody in the United States has hypertension. Because if it's not 120 over 80, it's hypertension. It's either elevated stage 1 or stage 2. In JNC8, I'm normal. In this recommendation, I'm at stage 2. You know the difference between the two?
What?
So when this came out, there was a big, huge brouhaha over this, about how tight this is, that everybody's going to have to be on antihypertensives. I just gave you a clue. Everybody's going to have, who do you think funded this study? Big Pharma. Big Pharma. That's the truth. JNC8 is an independent, non-biased organization. They make these recommendations. They don't put any brand names on here. This recommendation was loaded up. If you look at the study, a lot of these people are funded by Big Pharma. The American Academy of Family Physicians has just recently, as of last week, rejected this recommendation. So JNC8 is kind of where we're going. I don't know what Latassi is going to tell you, but that's kind of the bottom line. Any questions about this? All right, let's talk about atherosclerosis. Atherosclerosis is used interchangeably. What it really is, though, is arteriosclerosis. You can say arteriosclerosis, you can say atherosclerosis, it's the same thing. But understand that hardening of the arteries is on the small arterial side. I mentioned earlier that the small arteriole, with its tunica media, being able to contract and dilate, that's where pressure is regulated. Most. That's where pressure is regulated. couple of bullet points down here. 50% of all deaths in the U.S. are related to this process. When I say cardiovascular disease, probably the most, if you say MI, what causes MI? Is atherosclerosis of the coronary arteries. If you talk about stroke, what causes stroke? It's atheroma or emboli or thrombi related to vascular disease. And if you're over 40 years old, the process is starting. Now, what happens here, the development of atherosclerosis starts out as fatty plaque. When I say fatty, it's cholesterol fatty, not triglyceride fatty, but cholesterol fatty. The, pr- process involves not the media or the externa, but the tunica intima. The process of atherosclerosis involves between the subendothelium to the internal elastic lamina. Can we say it again?
Yes.
The process of atherosclerosis extends from the subendothelium to the internal elastic lamina. It doesn't involve the muscularis layer of the artery. It doesn't involve the adventitia. It just involves the intima. The problem with that is that if it involves the intima and you've got muscle behind it, where do you think this thing's going to grow? It's going to grow into the lumen, not out towards the adventitia. And as I mentioned earlier, if you have a decrease in flow or increased resistance to flow, you're going to have downstream problems. And that downstream problem is related to where is the blockage and how severe is the blockage. Now, we talked about when I lectured, I don't remember, it was a long time ago, it seems like, that when you have a rupture of the endothelium, you have underlying it von Willebrand's factor and other types of collagen that sets off thrombus formation. That's exactly what's going on. When you have an atheroma, which is atherosclerosis, I'll go through the process here in just a second, but when you have atheroma, as long as it stays there, it doesn't do anything, you're fine. It's when it ruptures and exposes the underlying von Willebrand factor, collagen, other mediators, that's when you wind up with blockage. Now, risk factors. Here are the major risk factors. You need to know these major risk factors. You know this is going to be on the test. You know it's going to be on your board. Interestingly, you're going to run into patients every now and again when you take their blood and you spin it, you will actually have a layer of fat on their blood in the vial that looks just like that. I mean, it's impressive when you see it. Usually it's not cholesterol, usually it's triglycerides. You have somebody with triglyceride level over 1,000, normally it should be less than a few hundred, but it's over 1,000. This is what their blood looks like. It's pretty impressive. So hyperlipidemia is a risk factor, and more specifically, hypercholesterolemia. Hypertriglyceridemia is not a risk factor for cardiovascular disease. It's a risk factor for pancreatitis and several other things, but not a risk factor for cardiovascular disease. Hypertension, I've already mentioned. Cigarette smoking is always the right answer on the board. It's always the right answer. I think in my entire 60 years, I've only seen one question where nicotine was not the right answer. So, and I think I wrote the question just because I wanted to see one question where nicotine was not the right answer. Diabetes type 1 or type 2 is a risk factor because it accelerates the rate of atherosclerosis. What are not major risk factors, but minor risk factors, are physical inactivity and obesity. Well, if they lead to diabetes, well, now you've got, but just being overweight and a couch potato is not a risk factor, or not risk factors by themselves. Tooth decay is interesting because of several things, what you eat, what you can't eat, what you can't eat, the amount of bacteria that end up in your blood through circulation on a chronic basis. So oral contraceptive use was a more significant factor than it is now. Now, because the hormone level in oral contraceptives are so low, it doesn't lead to the changes in lipids that it used to. The effect on the liver is actually what it is. Now, non-alterable influences, well, there they are. Okay. Now, if you look at cholesterol, cholesterol is the bad stuff. But you actually have to have it. You make cholesterol. Every cell in your body essentially makes cholesterol, endogenous. Plus, you eat cholesterol from animal sources. Plants don't have cholesterol. Animals do. If you eat more cholesterol, you wind up making less. If you eat less cholesterol, you'll make more. You have a set point in your body that's genetically determined about how much cholesterol you have and you make. You can modify that, obviously, with lipid-lowering drugs, but because they affect the synthesis of cholesterol. But you stop taking them, you're going to go right back to where you were genetically programmed in the first place. They're good on the good side of cholesterol. So it is the substrate for a whole bunch of things. One of them is it's critical for the cell membrane. It makes the cell membrane fluid. And because of its structure, you have a cell membrane. You don't have to have a cell wall like a bacterium does. It also forms the basic building block for all of your steroid-based hormones, your aldosterone, your cortisol, your testosterone, your estrogen. All of those are derived from cholesterol, every one of them. If you look at your body's load of cholesterol, as it says right here, 93% is intracellular. You have 7% circulates in your circulation, bound to a protein. Bound to a protein. I would add one more thing here, that bile acids, the way you get rid of cholesterol, one of the ways you get rid of it is through the biliary system. Now, these two points down here are important. LDL is the only element that has been shown to have a direct influence on atherosclerosis. LDL. The higher the LDL, the more likely you are to have a cardiovascular issue. An elevated HDL, high density lipoprotein, is a negative risk factor. So if your HDL level is above 60, then you have a negative. If I'm adding up my risk factors, well, I'm a smoker, I'm a diabetic, I have a total cholesterol of 300, 200 is the high normal, and an elevated LDL cholesterol, but I have a high HDL, then I can take off one of those risk factors. You can put those risk factors onto a table, and I can tell you, there's actually a thing on your phone that I can tell you that at 60 years old, you have a 28% chance of having a cardiovascular event within the next 10 years. It's that well refined, okay? Then you can take off one of those things if you have an elevated HDL. If you look at the lipids or lipoproteins, there are different elements here, different types. First is yes, ma'am.
So since the LDL and HDL can fluctuate, those aren't genetically set?
No, they are.
They are.
They're all, all of these are genetically set.
Okay.
Kind of microns are like drops of fat circulating in your system. They're big. You know, I always thought that when I was taking biochemistry, I always thought, when you pour, when you go to the Italian restaurant and they pour the oil onto the vinegar into the oil, the vinegar makes droplets, right? I always envisioned, that's what a chylomicron looks like, you know? Or you pour oil onto the surface of water, and it, you know, that's what chylomicrons look like. Chylomicrons have no clinical importance that we need to talk about. Now, I would imagine if you had some inborn error of metabolism where you didn't make them, that would be an issue, but, and I'm not even sure that exists, probably does, but they're not going to ever come up in your clinical discussions. Okay. Next to chylomicrons, though, is, and what you will get on a lipid panel, if you order, is a VLDL, very low density lipoproteins. That's the largest of the cholesterol-laden transport proteins. And then next to that is the LDL. There's an LDL receptor on cells that this will bind to it, getting cholesterol into the cell. HDLs are next. Okay. So, atheroma development. This, the next couple of slides kind of tells you how this process develops. And it develops, why it develops where it does, I can't give you a good answer about that. You remember from anatomy how the aorta crunched, how the common iliac would crunch, but the renal arteries never did. But then in these people over here, mostly African Americans, it will. So renal artery stenosis is a problem with African Americans, but not in Caucasians, really. The only one that I know of a reason for it developing is that you recall the left coronary artery comes around and gives off the circumflex and the LAD. That bit of left coronary artery there sits in the sulcus and it can move. It can move. There's enough fat around it where it moves. The thought is that it jiggles so much with each heartbeat that it's prone to develop atheroma because of the motion. I'm not sure if that's right, but that's the what I've heard. Okay, what happens is you wind up with an intact endothelium that gets invaded by essentially monocytes. Monocytes are premature what cells? Macrophages, right. So they can move in and out of the vasculature quite freely. They also, this area is accompanied also with platelets. Once you get a subendothelial invasion of macrophages, what's recruited to the site is LDL laden cholesterol. And of course, anytime you have macrophages and platelets, it's a snowball effect in terms of inducing, releasing mediators that will bring in other macrophages and platelets. Now, as LDL, the cholesterol, becomes incorporated into this wound, if you can call it that, the macrophages will eat the cholesterol. I'm simplifying this a little bit here, but nonetheless, when they eat the cholesterol, it stays within the cell and you have these vacuoles or granules within the cell with fat in them. They look like the cells are foamy. They're called foam cells. They're big, they're macrophages. What do macrophages do? They eat stuff, right? So the presence of foam cells means you have a maturing atheroma. At this point also, you have as the atheroma is developing, you don't have a lot of depth into the lumen yet, so flow is not impeded so much, but what you have is the appearance of yellow streaks on the, if you were to open up the vessel and look at it, it would look like there was yellow streaks where this process is ongoing. Those yellow streaks are called, and you know that fat is yellow, fatty streaks. Fatty streaks is an immature atheroma. It's probably written somewhere up on here, it is right here. Fatty streak, right there. Now, as this process keeps advancing, you get more and more incorporation, you get more and more invasion of cells, the actual center of the thing becomes necrotic. Also, on top of it here, you get a profusion of smooth muscle cells that underlie the endothelium, so you have a cap on it. You now have a structural cap. So what this looks like is you have the endothelium, you have the smooth muscle cells, you have the cap. Deep to that, you have the atheroma. If it's large enough, it becomes necrotic in the center. And on the bottom side, again, you have the tunica media. And this is what it looks like. The fibrous cap signals a mature atheroma. Now, at this point, you're interrupting laminar flow. So normally, as I think we've mentioned before, if you take a vessel and it's clean, clear, in the middle of the vessel you have nice laminar flow of blood. Around the edge of the vessel, around the inside lumen of the vessel, you actually have a vacuum that's created there where there's little flow, but then you put a bump in the middle of it, and now you're going to disrupt that laminar flow, and you're going to be able to hear it downstream as a brewery. Histologically, this is what it looks like. Here's the necrotic core, the fibrous cap, there's the lumen of the vessel. This would be the tunica media, the pink stuff out here, the red stuff. Now, the next 50 slides all say the same thing, just differently. So I was going to take them out last night, but then I decided to just leave them in because each one has probably a small little nippet of information that's useful here. The thing that's interesting here is that this defines the development. You have a fatty streak comes first, you have the fibrous plaque, and then as long as that fibrous cap doesn't rupture, if it's stable, you're fine. Here's the thing, this process takes a long time, decades, to develop normally. Like everywhere else in the body, if you start slowly decreasing the diameter of the main vascular supply, you're going to produce collateralization. around the site. And it's going to be, you're going to collateralize not with one vessel forming, but with dozens and dozens. So if you take an obstruction of the femoral artery, for example, and you do if a person comes in and they've been having ischemic changes in their right lower extremity for decades, and you do an arthrogram, they're going to have 24 or more vessels that go around that lesion. So collateralization is how you combat this, how your body will combat downstream hypoxemia. This one right here, I don't know where I got this slide, but why it says how it happened. It's part of the slide. I couldn't go and change that. But this is how it happened. Along this process here, this is stable, and that's fine. Here, you've got rupturing. And now this is where the problems are going to come in, when the thing ruptures. One of two ways. It ruptures, and you wind up with a thrombus at that site, or it ruptures and you have a cholesterol embolus headed somewhere else. If you survive it, this is what you wind up with, a narrowed lumen. In this illustration here, it's this part that I was interested in. When you have this, if you increase your myocardial oxygen demand, or if you increase the demand of your gastroc and soleus from increasing exercise, like walking from here to the car, if I have a 50% obstruction of my femoral artery, and I walk from here to the car, I've got to stop four times because my calves and my legs are cramping up. What's that called? Claudication. Claudication. C-L-A-U-D-A-cation. Claudication. Claudication means you have arterial peripheral vascular disease. So when you're doing when you have a patient over in Good Shepherd or somewhere, and you get the cardiovascular, you're looking at cardiovascular and peripheral vascular exam, I always ask them the same thing. You have chest pain, do you have dyspnea on exertion? And I can't walk more than 100 yards before I get out of breath. Do you have palpitations? Can you walk from here to the car without having to stop? And if you have to stop, why do you have to stop? Are you out of breath? Or you have to stop because your legs are cramping up? And that's what they'll do when they become hypoxic. It's also stable angina. If you go and walk to your car, I'm getting a little chest pain right here. If you sit down and rest, why are you getting chest pain? Because the downstream is hypoxic. Downstream myocardium is hypoxic. You sit down and rest a little bit, your heart rate comes down, myocardial oxygen demand goes down, the chest pain goes away. That's the best type of angina you can have. The worst type of angina you have is when you have clean vessels, but they spasm. What's that called? You know what that's called? It's called variant angina or unstable angina. Another word for it is Prinzmetals. P-R-I-N-Z-M-E-T-E-L. Prinz, like Prince, you know, the artist formerly known as. It's not Prince, it's P-R-I-N-Z. Prinz Metals angina is the same thing as variant angina. And what that is vasospasm. It's not blockage. And it's a more ominous issue. By the way, nobody asked me about my colonoscopy.
See, I thought about it and I was like, then they said, don't ask him.
Why not? If there was cancer in there, my happy ass wouldn't be here. I'd be on crack. But it was clean, clean as the whistle. Let me tell you, so propofol, the guy, the drug that killed Michael Jackson, that's what they use. So I sit in there, I'm lying there on the gurney, and they say, roll on your left side. So I roll on the left side. And I was looking at the clock, and the CRNA was, they had a big old, like a 60cc, well, 20cc syringe of propofol. And I saw her put half of it in, I'm thinking, oops, I feel that a little bit. And I look at the clock was right there, it was 8:10. 8:10. So I shut my eyes, and when I opened my eyes up, I was looking at my wife, it was 8:35. We done? Yeah, it was all over. And it came on so fast, I closed my eyes to blink, and I was gone. And when I opened my eyes from the blink, I had lost, 20 minutes of time, and it was over. And it was gone so much so, I'm lying, I was still on my left side. I opened my eyes up, and I was like, what the hell are you doing in here? And I noticed I was not in the suite, so I rolled on my back, and I'm set up, and whew, done. And 9 o'clock, I walked out of that place. We went to Jimmy's Egg, and so I want me some of that propofol. Take a break. No, go pee. Go do something.
There was a student requirement letter I had to fill out.
Really?
Yeah.
Where was that at?
On Blue Link, under student requirements, under financial services tab.
You're not.
You could submit it online or mail it in or just take it over there. I just mailed it.
Right. I'm going to email it for
you get financial services, and then it's like, if you scroll down, it's like in the middle of the screen. It's like student requirements or something.
Oh, mine says at the bottom of the email, so
your verification requirements or
whatever.
Or you can go to account summary under my account and make sure your balance is zero. The house is going to be pulling up like on my floor at the certain time. And my dad's going there to get home. Because he has to like get home.
Yeah.
And he has to go salad and pay
for it. Yeah.
Well, and we're like getting possessed. So like by the end of this month, they buy my whole get our money in the house.
I mean, it was half a day.
Yeah, they literally do that. At this point, they say.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, my mom's calling the lawyer right now, so we're legally. So you are in one of the girls that lives in the hall has a really weird life.
Yeah, we want to like get a picture.
So I can get them.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, it's like they stay. You have like a bond, and you know, my dad made for me. And they like, they put wine and stuff in it. Just open the wine and all the wine. And then didn't leave from the room. She was there. It was just a simple. It was like, you're not buying this house.
Yeah.
And they were taken back.